coming up on 7:07 in the morning on the Wake Up Tucson show, 10:30 The Voice, local news and talk. Before we get to our next guest, remember we're having our happy hour spring soiree is the official name of it. March 2nd, it's going to be on the patio out at St. Philip's Plaza, Grant Kruger's Great Places between Reforma, Union, and Proof. Please stop by. Party starts at 5 p.m., live music at 6 p.m. Let me know you're coming at wakeuptucsoncomments@gmail.com. Let's go right to the phones. We have Arizona National Guard, General Michael McGuire. General, good morning. Welcome to Wake Up Tucson. How are you, sir?
Good morning, Chris. Thanks for having me. I'm doing well.
So, of course, you came on everyone's radar. I mean, don't get me wrong, you were on our radar before Rona. We thought you were the greatest general in National Guard. No, I'm just kidding. But what I wanted to say was you came on the scene as part of Governor Ducey's team to deal with this last year. Just talk about the, changing kind of what you guys usually do in the National Guard to coronavirus, COVID-19 relief efforts. Talk about transitioning the force from, I mean, that's what you guys are built for transitioning, but talk about that process, sir.
Yeah, so I have the humbling privilege of running the Arizona Department of Emergency and Military Affairs, and in the emergency management role, we have about 60 civilians and about 40 civilian reservists that serve in the nearly 8,300 in all 15 counties in the state of Arizona. And their job is really to be ready to manage additional resource requests should there be a major disaster. You know, for the previous nearly 7 years of my tenure, Arizona is fairly disaster averse. But as you remember, March of last year, there was a declaration of emergency relative to the pandemic. The other nearly 7,600 and change military members of the organization, they're focused on being the primary combat reserve of the United States Army and the United States Air Force. But they have this ability, as you mentioned, to pivot back to be the labor force should we need triaging capability to deliver food, ice, water, medical supplies, which was the case last year. Most specifically, first specific 911 type call happened out at Navajo Nation, and we rolled from there into food sustainment missions and food banks and helping with logistics, moving trucking, whether it be food, PPE, and now medical supplies, and then building a medical task force that works a lot on first the testing and now vaccination of our citizens.
So you talk about a medical task force, because we're going to get there in relation to building up what you guys need as part of this next phase of the battle in the pandemic. Talk about building up the medical side of this, because, you know, I know you had medics as part of your crew, but talk about augmenting that part of the force.
Yeah, so in the Guard, of the nearly 7,600 military members, about 450 of them, Army and Air, are medical specialists. Doctors, nurses, PAs, medics, and a myriad of other medical admin and logistics folks. For those that weren't already employed in the healthcare industry in Arizona, as you know, all of our guardsmen are your neighbors. They serve as citizen soldiers and airmen, so they may be teachers or work at your radio station or somewhere in all 15 counties. And then if we call them to duty and strip them away from a Banner medical facility, it's a zero sum. But we have a number of them that don't work in the medical industry, and we've tried to get them on. And that's about 185 of the nearly 450 that we've called to duty nearly immediately, and they've been on duty ever since. We have another nearly 750 that are doing all of the back-end support, be it moving vaccine, doing traffic control, helping with IT and administration for everything from testing and tracking of PPE to now helping out with folks out at the sites in typically rural and tribal communities, because we found Pima and Maricopa County have the most people and also the greatest depth of talent to help out in this way.
So what have you learned so far from March to now we're in February? What have you learned in dealing with something that you guys have really never dealt before? Talk about the learning curve for you and your command team.
Well, I didn't know much about epidemiology and spread of viral diseases and how to mitigate the spread of the disease and all those types of things. So I've gotten a pretty good education in the last year, but relative to how we've handled the problem, we've been able to adapt a military solution for sustainment and logistics and support for really all of our first response centers. So really in any kind of an emergency, your first responder is going to be your Pima County Sheriff, your local Tucson Fire, whoever it might be. And if they need additional resources, they come to us as the state. At our agency, we see if there's a way to source it from another county, another city, wherever it may be. And in this case, when all 15 counties are suffering impacts at the same time, we have to now turn to our federal partners at FEMA and Department of Defense and Health and Human Services to bring things in. And so I've learned a lot about that process of working with our federal partners. Obviously, you can do a lot of tabletop exercises and prep for these kind of things, but in almost all scenarios, that exercise ends at 1 or 2 days and everybody goes home. In this particular case, this has been, as you mentioned, nearly a year since we declared a statewide emergency.
So, General McGuire, what have you learned in the last 11 months about dealing with the media? Because you've probably done more media stuff in the last 11 months than you probably did your entire career, and dealing with the media in relation to a public health crisis. What lessons have you learned with that, a lot of microphones being shoved in your face?
Well, I've learned that the media is an outstanding conduit for information, and we certainly need a media that's willing to pass through the message. It's very hard for us to get the message out, and we need it in so many different forms, radio, TV, social media, and I appreciate their partnership. I said to somebody one day that, you know, we get thanked for our service, or have been for many years, you know, trained in very high public trust, those of us in uniform. And while all this has been going on, we've deployed just in Arizona alone almost 1,300 Arizona National Guardsmen to the Middle East, the Far East, or other deployments for their military missions. And I say, you know, the media has been very good about reaching out and trying to pass the message on. I'll give you an example. Most recently, one of the things we did as we started these vaccination sites was we realized we needed more folks that were qualified to give vaccines because we were focusing at each of these vaccination sites in that post-vaccination monitoring period for nurses, EMTs, doctors, to make sure nobody has any kind of an allergic reaction. Quite a few retired nurses and doctors that are in our either our seasonal community or have retired recently or may not be working in the medical career field. And we've been working in the Guard to bring in kind of a volunteer vaccination brigade. And the media has been key in helping get those people, that word out to folks that want to volunteer, to get trained up by our medical task force to be added as a volunteer in that specific area. So and I appreciate the help.
I definitely want to talk about the point of distribution that's coming up at the University of Arizona today. One last question before we go to commercial break, General. How about the employers of your guardsmen? Because they have had to be probably in the midst of whatever's going on with their business levels with a public health crisis. They have to be flexible to let your crew leave work and do work for you guys.
You bet. And we couldn't. The Guard, you know, is 1634 first territorial governor at the Massachusetts Bay Colony, 1636 first adjutant general, and formation of a National Guard or a state's colonial militia. And at every turn, we couldn't do that without both the volunteerism of the members and their great patriotic service, and the patriotic service of all the employers that allow these folks to go out for 6, 8, in this case, nearly 12 months, and then return to their local community, being part of our great economy. And I couldn't say thank you more to them. I really, you know, feel embarrassed at times for people saying thanks for my service to me, when I want to say thanks to all of the community for how they've banded together and responded. Very proud of how each community has taken on this challenge.
All right, we're talking to General Michael McGuire. We're going to do one more segment, and we're going to concentrate on what's happening today at the University of Arizona with the new pod that they're opening up for vaccinations. So questions or comments, wakeuptucsoncomments@gmail.com or 790-2040. Wake up. It's an M day here at Wake Up Tucson. There you go. Hey, look at that. We got a General Michael McGuire on M Wednesday here. That's good. All bump music starts with M today, bands. General McGuire, welcome back, sir.
Thanks, Chris.
So give us the basics of what's happening today at the University of Arizona in the Tucson State of Arizona pod. Give us the details, please.
So University of Arizona had a great setup there. We had been asked by the governor's staff back around January 11th to try to increase throughput capacity and look at potentially doing 24-hour operations. And our first attempt at that was at Cardinal Stadium at State Farm Stadium up in Glendale. Arizona Department of Health Services is kind of the policy lead for how we handle vaccines, and my agency was tasked with the organization of operationalizing that, bringing people together, working with all of our partners to get that set up. We subsequently built a second large drive-through site at Phoenix Municipal Stadium over there just north of Arizona State University in Tempe. And the third site we're working to expand is a site that already was run by the University of Arizona, visited it last week, and it's a soft opening today. I think the initial plan is to open until 10 o'clock in the evening with a plan for us to ultimately get to, as you mentioned in your opening, a 24-hour operation, an ability to do 6,000 vaccines per day on a drive-through basis while they keep the walk-on clinic. They have a walk-in clinic associated with that also, really good operation. So we're going to expand hours of operation today. I think they originally opened up 12,000 additional appointments, and they filled up in less than 2 hours.
When does it open today, General?
We are having the press event this afternoon. I believe it's at 3 o'clock. Down in Tucson. I'll be down in Tucson this afternoon. And there's a soft opening, and then the full capability for appointments begins on Saturday. So this Thursday, Saturday will be the first full day of operation that way.
Let's talk about staffing this. I know there sounds like there might be a need for volunteer folks in the Tucson area to come help out. What do you need, and how do they help?
So the University of Arizona Incident Command Team has been managing that site. I think they were originally running from about 10 a.m. to 4 in the afternoon, so about 6 hours of operation. They were able to staff that organically with folks from their campus staff as well as their medical school and other parts of the university. As they expand out operation, the basic core needs that we'll have are folks to help folks do data entry as people arrive. Obviously, the medical professionals that do both the vaccine, the actual vaccination and monitoring, and then some folks to do traffic control. We have a statewide portal on the Arizona Department of Health Services website called ESARVIP. It's click on it for a volunteer tab, and you can go to there at AZDHS and click the volunteer tab and get entered in that way to qualify. Put your zip code in, and we'll get you your name over to the local site, and they'll contact you.
Is that the same place that they would go to sign up for future vaccines at this site?
It is. It's a different part of the website, but the same portal, correct.
There are some local officials at the county and some other places that are mildly kind of miffed that you guys are opening up this site, and they're saying the fact is that you're going to be taking away doses of vaccine from the county's efforts, and they say this is a negative for the region. General McGuire, I assume you think it's not a negative for the region. Why would you say that? I just want to get your side of this.
Well, we're not going to take remove vaccine from any other site to keep this site operational. U of A already had an allocation of vaccine as one of the authorized pods in the county system. We're simply augmenting and adding to their staff. U of A will continue to operate as a Pfizer site. They have a great cold chain storage operation. And it makes it much simple if we don't mix the types of vaccine, Moderna or Pfizer, at the site. So U of A will continue to do that. We will direct Pfizer vaccine, as you mentioned, to continue to keep them open. There has been delays in the nation because of the severe weather in Texas with the distribution hubs.
Sure.
So we are looking like we're going to miss a week of deliveries, which will potentially affect some of the sites. But right now I'm hearing that at least at the U of A site, the Pfizer vaccine, we have ample amount on hand to cover what we have scheduled right now.
Excellent. And one last question. Thank God it looks like the numbers are tumbling down pretty hard across the board when it comes to cases, hospitalizations, ventilations, and all that, right? That we're seeing the same numbers?
Exactly. DHS, Arizona Department of Health, they track the statewide numbers, but we're seeing very positive trends and reductions in positivity rate pretty rapidly over the last couple of weeks.
All right. General McGuire, thanks for your efforts over the last 11 months, and hopefully we can all get out of this thing faster than we ever thought. Well, it's longer than we ever thought, but faster from this point than we thought we would get out of here. So hopefully we get there.
You bet. Amazed that the speed the vaccine was developed and rolled out, and I think we're on the backside of the curve, and hopefully we'll soon be back to normal.
All right, General McGuire, thanks for the time. We appreciate it. Let's revisit soon with a couple of update discussions, okay?
Okay. Thanks a lot, Chris.
Thank you, sir. Have a good day.
Bye-bye.
That is General Michael McGuire from the Arizona National Guard. So when we come back, I asked the question, right? We're going to talk about, I'm going to do my reading of the Steve Kozacik press release. And I think, Tom, our song that we've chosen, we've gotten some nice suggestions, but I think the one that we're going to do is the one because it fits Kozacik perfectly, I think, also. So we're going to have the debut of that song and my reading of the Steve Kozacik, letter about the state of Arizona. The thing that General McGuire was just talking about is a negative effect on the county after General McGuire just said it doesn't affect the dosages that the other ones are getting. But Steve's a know-it-all, so he's a bigger know-it-all than me, and that's amazing. So 10:30 The Voice, local news and talk.